Hi, this is Medhamsh. I work at IIIT, International Institute of Information Technology at Hyderabad. This is all about a project sponsored by Ministry of Human Resource Development, and this project is run by the Central Government of India. The project name is Virtual Labs. In this talk, I would rather tell how we are achieving things to be done. It's about developing several labs and testing them and releasing them. I would like to walk through the process, how we are dealing with it, and I would like to have suggestions from you people how better it can be scaled up and taken forward. So, as I said, Virtual Labs is a project which aims to create a lab space for the student, a virtual lab space, not needing necessarily for the student to go to a physical lab and do the experiments. And this project is run across several institutions, several IITs and IIITs and other institutions. And there are two kinds of labs. This is the website of Virtual Labs, vlab.co.in. And these are the broad areas of Virtual Labs you have labs in. So basically there are two kinds of labs, known as simulation and computational labs, and the other are remote triggered labs. If we want to teach a student how a generator works or how a robotic arm works, possibly all these IITs facilitate that robot to be used by other students across other colleges and universities. So what a student needs to do is have a browser in his own computer, goes there and tries to connect to those devices. He writes a program to control the robot and he executes it in the browser, and that action is executed by that robot over there. It's all captured in a webcam and streamed to the student later. So these types of labs are called remote triggered labs. Several IITs commission their motors, generators, electrical equipments and electronic equipments to be utilized by people across. So these experiments are called as remote triggered labs. And there are other computational labs known as simulation labs. Whereas if you want to teach a student how to do C programming, how to do image processing, things like that, these labs are called as simulation and computational labs. So for this, all a student needs is to have a computer with a browser running in it, and he goes to the URL, books a slot, and does the experiment. So there are around 180 simulation and computational labs around. So as I have shown it here, these are the broad areas of the labs people keep on developing. And the developers of these labs are professors across all these universities and people working with them, the research scholars and the programmers working with them. So this is the community of the developers right now. And the motto of this project is to grow this community of developers. The project is trying to increase this community and open this project up so that several developers across can come and join and contribute their own experiments, their own labs and all. And there is certain workflow for this development process. People just sign up at a portal, get their accounts and start with developing their labs, and they test them and they deploy, and at the end of the day, all the normal engineering colleges should get access to these labs. So there is a private cloud that needs to be deployed in each of the colleges, and there is a central instance running where students can just get connected to that and do the labs. So this is the architecture of the labs basically. And to show how a computational lab is, I would walk through the lab, how things are there. And we are a team of three people who provide the infrastructure and the platform for these developers to develop their labs, test them and distribute them. So this is the website which we maintain and run at IIIT Hyderabad. We categorize all the labs, and I would like to show how a lab works, and then deal with how the community gets in contact with this infrastructure provisioning team, and how a lab gets started and how it gets developed and all. So for example, computer science has all these labs, data structures, computer programming, problem solving and all this stuff. I would walk through a sample lab. So now I am assuming a role app for student going to this URL, reading the introduction about it, and there are a list of experiments. Right now, each subject is divided as a lab, and each lab has 10 experiments in it. And there are target audience for each of the subject. The first, third year undergrads and first year postgrads, like that. And courses aligned to these labs are categorized and even published over there. Each of the university has some course aligned to this lab. So, for example, this is an experiment in the image processing, point operations. There is an objective of the experiment, and there you have the introduction. Here is the theory, which the subject expert in image processing understands. A student is supposed to read all this. It's all about applying linear function, non-linear function, and all the stuff to an image. And here is the algorithm and formulae. Here he reads the procedure of doing this experiment. And this is his real experiment space. So basically, here in this example, a student is supposed to choose an image. And he's applying certain slope with certain offset. And this slope and this offset is applied in an algorithm, and that algorithm is executed in some C++ programming language. So this is what the resultant image would be if we apply certain slope and offset to that image. And if we execute that algorithm in the backend, this is what a student achieves. So basically, to teach this, there is a professor who conceptualizes all this part. So we have to do all these experiments in it and all. So there are people working with him, the programmers. They make all this programming in it. And in the backend, they're running a C++ program which gets compiled with these values substituted in the algorithm. And when they run it, the student gets the resultant thing. And this is how a student is supposed to learn using virtual labs. So here, the contract is between the developer and the infrastructure providing team, as in we. So what we do is we make sure that the developer has a server on which he can compile a C++ program, and we provide a test server for him so that he does all his testing in that test server. And then when he wishes to release it, he does a release of that lab. That lab goes and gets deployed in the deployment server, and then for each and every release, that gets packaged as a Debian package and put in a local repository. And the plan is to have the private cloud set up in each of the colleges, and they get updates as soon as the developer commits an update, it gets packaged and sent as an update to the private cloud sitting in the college. So for this, initially we had this would be the schematics of integration, how a lab developer gets in contract with the infrastructure provider and all. So every lab developer has a workspace which is his own machine, and he has a version control server, he has a test server, a deployment server, and all these servers are maintained in the backend. And now we have a project management portal, which basically is Redmine with custom built plugins for it. And a lab developer, when he gets an account, he just pushes his SSH public keys over there, and using that interface he creates a version control repository. He checks it out and he just fills the server side requirements which he needs in that portal. Those get installed, and a test server will be commissioned with those server side requirements installed in it. And then basically you can test in the test virtual machine, and then he can release it and it gets released. So initially we started with so the first year, this is the second year of the project. In the first year we had a version control server and a UI toolkit. UI toolkit is basically like a mini content management system. So if we go to each lab, we just took care in such a way that each lab has an introduction section, a list of experiment section, and there is a blue icon something and all. So what we felt is developers should basically put their efforts in making the lab rather than doing all this interface and stuff. So we gave a mini content management system, which basically is a set of HTML5 and CSS files. So when he creates a version control repository over there, when he does a first checkout, he gets this UI toolkit with him. And there is one single HTML file where he needs to write all this introduction. So each of this section will become a section tag in the HTML file, and he fills in this thing, and when he does a commit, it gets all this proper shape and stuff. So in the first version, during our first year of this developmental framework, we had a version control server and this UI toolkit, and we had to start with 30 developers across. We had POSIX accounts and for this SVN server and the test server. I just used to manually create those accounts and ask for their SSH keys. They used to mail me the SSH keys. And then we have a test server where they just go and put their code in public, and each of the developer has his own home directory, and he has a web publishable directory in it. So when the developer feels that his code is running fine, he puts his stuff in a directory called final-build, from which we used to pick and just push it onto the deployment server. And whatever the software side requirements they need, like the C++ compiler or Python compiler, all those things, they used to mail me, and we used to handle manually, install them, go and install them in test servers and the deploy servers. And if they need a database access, all that was in mails, and we used to do stuff manually. And then later we had a kind of platform as a service scheme where we picked up Redmine. Redmine is basically a bug tracking tool where you can submit issues and bugs. There we have made some custom Ruby plugins, Ruby on Rails plugins, to make this process into a smooth way. So I have my colleague here, Shweta. Probably she would like explaining how this portal works and all. So,
hello everyone, this is Shweta, and I work for Virtual Labs. And as my colleague told you, what is the process we follow and what are the models that we have built in order to make the lab developers work easier. So I'll just explain you how our portal is used in order to deploy your lab. I mean any lab. So first of all, this is an open source tool which the Redmine, which we use to customize in our way so that it will be suitable for our infrastructure. So we have developed some plugins, and this is developed in Ruby on Rails. And here I'll tell you a sample project how to deploy it. Just go to the project. Just example lab. This is the lab name. ENGG01 is the lab. And the members for this particular project will be the lab developer, the professor, and also the persons working under him when we are developing the lab. Maybe it might be research assistant, or they might be a programmer under him. So the main plugins that we have developed is SSH key. So the main motive of this is to provide a key authentication to the server. We have an SVN server, which is a development server. So basically, this is a means of authentication for that particular server. And also, in that server, we also provide the UI kit, where we follow the model to control architecture. So I'll tell you that later when it comes to the versioning. After you update your key here, then you get access to the server, SVN server. And then later on, you move to the SVN admin plugin, where you create the repositories. And here after, create a new repository here. Yeah, just give a name of the repository and your description of the repository. So let's see what you get with the repository. Then I'll explain you what we are providing. So after you create your repository, you have to do an SVN checkout of that particular repository sitting on the server. When you check out this repository, you get a local copy of the directory that is sitting on the server, and you can work on your local machine. You know how SVN works, right? So it's just a commit and repeat. So normally, whenever you check out an empty repository, your revision is 1. So here you'll get a UI kit sample where basically the complaints we got from the lab developers who are professors are like, we don't want to worry about the UI part. Just we need the content, because we are the content developers. We need to focus on the content. So what we have done is we have provided them the UI kit, which is it'll help them not worrying about the U part of it. So if you go to the lab, you have a content.html, index.html. So what we do is whatever you need to change the content, that is change the content.html, and index.html will dynamically load the content when you run a make. So this is the basic, just open the content.html so that I'll explain. So content.html is nothing but there's the sections and the headers. In each and every particular section is like a introduction, list of experiments, and inside the list of experiments you have objective, procedure and simulation, etc. So what the lab developer needs to do in this is they have to just edit the div tags here, and just they need to worry about is the content, not the any of it, not the style of it. So after editing some of the content, this will show you how these are reflected when you deploy it. So actually, in order to improve this, because people say that they don't know HTML also, because professors sometimes don't understand HTML. So what we are thinking is we are trying to put this into org mode and convert, publish it to HTML, and then do a build. So that'll be more easier for them to work with. So org mode is a basic editing tool. It is a plugin for Emacs. So that is So after doing the changes, you just do an SVN commit. So you're at revision 2. So just again, let's go to the portal, and also I want to tell you about the server side requirements here. Normally when a lab is developed, you need some server side requirements, because whenever you do simulation, there is some software the backend that is running. So you always give your input to the software, I'll execute and show you the results. So you have to give us the software requirements that needs to be run on the test server and the deploy server. So basically we have some restrictions here. As we are running the Debian operating system in the backend, we are asking for the Debian packages. And here if you just request for a package, and there's a wrapper at the backend which is doing an apt-get to install the package in the server.
So here this package installation is not yet fully automated. Yeah. We are just running a cron, picking the packages which users, the developers enter here, are taken into a JSON file, and apt-get is run by a Python script in the background.
Will you want to improve this, maybe by implementing Puppet or any configuration management tool to automate the whole process. So actually we are running a cron job at the backend in order to install the packages. And next we'll go to the releases, where the actual part of the deployment is here. And there is some Python wrapper that we have written in the backend, which is doing just apt-get install. So for every 30 minutes, we are running a cron job. Right.
So what you could do is, if you use Pristan, when you are having a case, so what you could do is you could use Pristan and remember some of the code. So from maybe like you can use Fabric to
Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
That's what
that's
our future what, thing is.
Yeah.
We just wanted to tell how.
That's what we need suggestions from you because it's still in developing stage. So here, in order to test your lab that you have change in the local machine, first just do a test lab, and then here you give the repository name that you have checked out, and also the revision number. Sorry, revision number is 2. So now, from the double machine, your code is there is a makefile which is run, and you get the final build, and that is asking to the test server, and you have all the software requirements on the test server as well as the deploy server. So you can just check the link on the test server first. So we have changed the content here. Welcome to RootConf, and also the RootConf. Introduction is changed to the RootConf. So this is how we give them the testing platform. So normally whenever, before, when we were not there, I mean, they were like, they used to deploy it without testing. So there were a lot of issues from a lot of people, the users who are using. People are not liking the lab because there's some connection problem, there is some software problem which is not running in the backend. So there were a lot of issues, and we have come up with the solution of having the test server and then deploy it. So when you think that everything is working in the test server, then you make a call and tell your lab developer, I mean the professor, and then release the lab for the final deployment. So when you do a make a release, the lab is automatically deployed. I mean whatever is there in the test server will be pushed to the deploy server. So you need to sign an agreement where you say that your content is licensed, and also your softwares which you are using are not proprietary and which are open source. So it's not like you should not use proprietary software, but you have to provide license for it.
This is the test server, test.virtuallabs.com, and this is the deploy server. So here we are enforcing in a way that they can release only one when they test it. The recently tested lab will be deployed. So it's a kind of an enforcement for them to definitely test it before releasing it. And this is the end of this portal.
Obviously the lab development is not like, you can't freeze the lab development. Or obviously the student wants more. So obviously we are making sure that the whatever feedback the lab the users are giving will be reached to the lab developer in order for the continuous development, and the lab is developed.
Like you guys
also
you could do that.
Right. So there's something called code coverage. Basically, what it does is that how much of the code has been tested. Okay, there's standard software.
Code coverage.
Yes, you need to append the code which is added recently.
Yeah, so, should be only deployed when you have 100% is a bit.
You're not to dump the stuff from test server to the deployer.
So, I mean, maybe you could do this.
We have it in the future.
We would like to
migrate everything from SVN to JIT.
So, then maybe like you have this comment. I mean, post receive that. So, then like everything would automatically migrate.
Exactly.
Right.
So, now we have like this, we have picked up Redmine for issue tracking and made this custom plugins on top of it. And we have LDAP, open LDAP based accounts for all the developers. And then these are the custom plugins, so it's just key based authentication and SVN admin, UI toolkit with two themes. And packages request in the Redmine portal. It's basically taking them in a JSON file and installing it, running an app, test the lab and test server, release only if the test is finished. And then we are currently making them as Debian packages manually. We are have written some manifests and running a dev build. So eventually the packages get created. And then we are pushing them to a local app repository and making live CDs and per college installations. We are doing a the plan is to now we are doing updates to the repositories. And for this, we have the following hardware. We have a 2 IBM X3650 M3 servers with 32 GB of RAM image and 5 TB hard disk image. And we have Debian as the base operating system and virtual instances, hybrid virtual instances using OpenVC and KVM for fully virtualization. And yeah, from the next update onwards, Debian is not giving OpenVC. Deprecating it, so we're planning to move to LXCs, Linux. It has LXC is there in the kernel itself, and then we are using Apache for web server and all mod reverse proxies and stuff to point to all the virtual machines, and Redmine as the base.
So maybe you could also use that. You could have like predefined configuration
files. Yeah, and the problems we have, the kind of problems we have is. Actually, for right now we don't have a test VM per each lab.
Okay.
We have a test server where things are running.
So
So we have a plan of having one test VM per each lab, and Zen is a bit costly. Probably we could go with hybrid virtualization. In terms of resources,
yeah. So I mean, Zen would be very good for that because Zen has
like, of course. But we had good experience with LXCs, LX and OpenVC. So this problem of two labs requesting different versions of each software could be answered by this. And we have invested some time in looking at functional package management. And then we came across to a conclusion that it requires a lot of disk space for storing cache. And there is another problem. Lab developers are requesting particular version of the library or particular version of software. And we don't know if we do a system upgrade if their labs works with that software or not. So that kind of testing we want to do and automate. So yeah, if we do a security upgrade and if that package gets upgraded, we don't know if that lab gets broken or if it still works. So we want to automate that kind of thing in it. Yeah, so these are our future plans. You know, we want to have a per lab virtual machine, and we want to have an auto builder of packages, which we are doing manually right now. And we want to give APIs for persistence. Right now we are giving only the UI toolkit to the lab developers. So this would make the users, they would do 4 experiments, log out, come back and continue from the 5th experiment. And we want to do something for the remote triggered labs. Right now we are concentrating only on computational labs. So labs which deal with remote triggeredness, like controlling robots or electric motors, generators, we want to provide some kind of API for them. And we want to write an auto builder distro mechanism to ship them for the colleges and individual users. And the thing is to migrate everything from HCI to Git. And this year we have plans of mirroring the deployment server for disaster management, anticipating it. And the plan is to make it as a CDN. All the mirrors would come under CDN nodes. So these are our future plans which we want to plan. And we just came here to learn about various automated stuff like Puppet Chef and other auto builder tools, and want to go back and implement them. This is it. If you have some suggestions, there is a mailing list, vlabs-dev@virtuallabs.org. And in fact, our trials are to increase this developer community. We want to have people around to develop their own labs, teaching programming languages, databases and all, design experiments. There are very good areas like we could teach system programming and just basic design skills to the students. So we basically provision virtual machines and give some kinds of exercises where people can come and learn basic commands and other stuff.
So how many of you are managing this?
Sir?
How many of you are managing this development?
Yes sir.
Yeah.
I mean,
the portal stuff.
Portal,
yes.
And,
we are three
back
of us.
You're
three
also managing the servers.
Yeah, we are three of us. So, basically one guy does all kinds of support contract with the developers and tries to help them out. And we both do the plugin development and maintain the server. So now we want to go back and implement some kind of configuration management system and use make this into
automate
solid.
The whole process.
You guys are at IIT, IIIT,
triple IIT. So we also want to open up this infrastructure development project, and we would like to developers come across and join this and develop. So right now we have posted all the code and configurations in wikis, and we want to move all this to some GitHub or Gitorius stuff. There is developer wiki and technical notes here.
We also conduct some workshops in order to educate programmers with SVN and JIT.
So all the content of each lab is released under Creative Commons, and the software they make, all these experiments are created under GPL. This is the mandate from the government. So, anyone could just come and develop labs and do their own sorts of